Hi. So today I'm going to talk about targeted genome engineering strategies to treat beta-hemoglobin disorders. So before going into my presentation, let me introduce my lab. My lab is relatively young at IGIB. I'm working on two different aspects, mainly on monogenic hematological disorders like sickle cell anemia, beta thalassemia, and hemophilia. So in this, we are trying to use cutting edge genome editing approach to correct the particular disease causing mutations in patient derived human induced pluripotent stem cells. So that is one aspect, and simultaneously we are also trying to create some of the beneficial mutations for correcting for beta thalassemia and sickle cell anemia. So, and the second aspect is we are trying to create a human-induced pluripotent stem cell repository or bank for diseases that affect the Indian population. So, this will be a good this can be used for disease modeling, drug discovery and development, and in long run, it can be used as a cell replacement therapy in near future. So, with this, I'll start my presentation. So today, as I said, I'm going to talk about targeted genome engineering to treat beta-hemoglobin disorders. So first slide, I'll start asking a question, can we able to edit a particular mutations in the human genome? So that is what we have asked the question. In this, the sickle, we are mainly working on two different disease, two hematological disorders, as I told. One is the sickle cell anemia. This is the autosomal recessive disorder. It's a single gene, monogenic disorders. This is the most prevalent in tribal population in India. So, if you see in my slide, left side, this is the normal amino acid sequence of the normal beta-globin gene. There is a wild type sequence in this amino acid 6, that's the glutamic acid. So if you see in the right side, this is the single amino acid change which alters from glutamic acid to a valine. So basically single nucleotide which alters the one single amino acid at the sixth position from glutamic acid to valine. So in the normal sickle cell anemia normal individuals, the healthy red blood cells are flexible that can able to pass through the small capillaries. So they contain multiple hemoglobin molecules that carry the oxygen from lungs to other parts of the body. So the normal lifespan of the RBC is 120 days. But if you see in sickle cell anemia patients, the sickle cell sickle cells contain the defective form of hemoglobin that when not bound to oxygen causes them to bend into the crescent shape, so that can't able to pass through the blood vessels. So then the oxygen carrying capacity get reduced, so there are other symptoms can causes. So in this case, the sickle cell RBCs, the red blood cells, is the lifespan is only 20 days, so then you have to go for the regular blood transfusion. So it will be very complicated, so you have to go, it depends on the severity of the disease, you have to go for the blood transfusion. So the next disease is the beta thalassemia. Unlike sickle cell anemia, in beta thalassemia also the mutation is in the same gene, the beta globin gene, but the mutation is spread across the gene. So there are some deletions, insertions, or in the introns also there is some deletions or insertions. So it's like a heterogeneous disorder at the genetic level. It is caused by more than 200 different mutations in the beta globin gene. As I told, this is mostly deletions, insertions on base or base pair substitutions. So these mutations results in reduced or no synthesis of the beta globin molecule, so leading to the surplus production of alpha globin. So there will be an imbalance between the alpha and beta globin chain. So this is the second hematological disorder. So what are the, so if you want to go for the gene or cell replacement therapy, because there currently there is no permanent cure for these disorders, like both in sickle cell anemia or beta thalassemia. So only the cure is bone marrow transplantation. So you, for that you have to look for the suitable donor. It will be very difficult. Apart from that, there is only a drug which is available in the market. This is the only FDA approved drug, is the hydroxyurea. So which increases the fetal hemoglobin levels that can be used for the treatment, but this is not the permanent cure. So if you think about the cure, you have to go for either gene correction or gene and cell replacement therapy. So what are the limitations of the current methods to manipulate the mammalian genome? So there are two major limitations. One is very low rate of homologous recombination. So if you want to correct a particular mutation, say example in the case of β-globin, so you need to correct a particular mutation from glutamic acid to valine, that's the mutation. So in that case, the homologous recombination efficiency is very, very low. That is 1 into 10 to the power of 5 to 7. So that is like 1 in 1 million cells. So, and the other disadvantage is there are random integration and non-targeted integration elsewhere in the genome. So these two things, either low rate of homologous recombination and random integration, these are the major limitations in the current methods. So given these limitations, there are recent advances in the genome editing approaches. Using gene editing nucleases, you can correct the particular gene mutation, and then it can be used for cell and replacement therapy in near future. So I'll just start with simple, so for the audience, start with the DNA restriction enzymes. So you can able to, before going into what is gene editing nucleases, so these are all came from at least in the first generation gene editing nucleases like zinc finger nucleases and talons, it came from the DNA cutting enzymes like restriction enzymes. So restriction enzymes are DNA cutting enzymes. Each enzyme recognizes one or few target sequences that cuts at near or those sequences. Say example EcoR1, PSP1, NOT1 or SAL1, these restriction enzymes which binds and it cuts at the same locus. Okay, so these most common restriction enzymes cuts 1 in 4000 base pair and average in the human genome. So these can't be used for either specific gene correction or if you want to make any knockout in the human genome. So this is called type 2 restriction enzymes. There are another class called type 2S restriction enzymes. This example is FOC1, so which has two domains. One is the nuclease domain, one is DNA binding domain and the nuclease domain. So the DNA binding domain, it binds at the DNA binding domain, the FOC1, and it cuts away from the DNA binding domain. So it has two domains, as I showed here in the slide. So it cleaves 9 nucleotide downstream of first strand and 30 nucleotide upstream of the second strand. So with these enzymes you can't able to correct. So you need to have the hybrid restriction enzymes or gene editing nucleases. So what happened? So in 1990s, Indian origin scientist Professor Srinivasan Chandrasekharan from Johns Hopkins University. So he came up with an idea that hybrid restriction enzymes. So he has taken a zinc finger DNA binding domain and then fused it with a FOC1 restriction endonuclease. So and then he has created the zinc finger nucleases. So zinc finger is a transcription factor. It's a DNA binding domain which it has a fingers. So each finger can able to bind 3 nucleotides. So you can able to synthesize your own zinc finger DNA binding domain to target a particular gene of interest. So you can stitch 3 or 4 zinc finger DNA binding motifs, and then in the 3' end you can fuse the FOC1 nucleases. So that can target 12 to 15 base pair. That will be the top strand zinc finger nuclease, right? And the bottom strand, you can generate another zinc finger nuclease which can able to target 12 to 15 base pairs. So the FOC1 nucleases has to get through dynamic. So basically, if you deliver this zinc finger nucleases, both left and right, it goes and binds to the target locus, and the FOC1 nuclease heterodimerizes and makes the double stranded break. So once the double stranded breaks can be this double stranded breaks can be corrected by two pathways in the genome, or either it can go into non-homologous enjoining or it can be corrected by homologous recombination approach. So that I will explain to you in coming slides. So the next gene editing nuclease is the talons. It's a transcription activator like effector nucleases. So here the tail is the DNA binding motif, which was which is present in naturally found in Xanthomonas bacteria. It's a plant pathogen. It has the DNA binding domain, which is composed of series of 33 to 35 amino acid repeats. So these repeats are largely identical, except two highly variable amino acids at position 12 and 13, which is called as repeat variable domains. It's called, otherwise it's RVDs. So each repeat recognizes one base pair. It's like in zinc finger nuclease, each zinc finger can able to recognize three base pairs, but in here talons can able to recognize only one base. So the major advantage in this talon is the zinc finger nucleases are each zinc finger is influenced by the neighboring ones, but in talons each tail units are not influenced by the neighboring ones. So similarly, like in zinc finger, here in the tail units you can fuse the fork one nuclease domain and it can be delivered to the cell of interest. So that binds to the target locus and it makes the same double stranded break. The third and recent one is the CRISPR-Cas9 approach. CRISPR-Cas9, it's a clustered regularly interspaced palindromic riptoid. This is naturally present. The bacteria uses this system as a defense mechanism against the viruses. So it's a prokaryotic adaptive immune system that uses the RNA guided nuclease or Cas9 to silence the foreign viral nucleic acids. So recently it was engineered for the targeted genome engineering purpose. So here in 2011 and 12, Jennifer Doudna and Charpentier, they have shown that it has three components. In the native system, it has three components. One is the tracer RNA, CRISPR RNA, and the Cas9. The CRISPR RNA, which recognizes the 20 base pair specific region, and the tracer RNA, which gives the stability to the CRISPR RNA. And then the Cas9 is the nuclease, which makes the double stranded break. So the two scientists, the Charpentier and Jennifer Doudna, they have simplified the system. So they have fused this CRISPR-Cas9 and tracer RNA, and then they made synthetic guide RNA. Instead of three components, now it's only two components. One is synthetic guide RNA and the Cas9. So this is called an engineered Cas9 system. So the CRISPR-Cas9 system also recognizes the DNA through RNA-DNA interaction between the target site and the CRISPR-based guide RNA. So here the Cas9 makes the double stranded break in a DNA at the site which is determined by the 20 base pair CRISPR RNA or synthetic guide RNA. So if you have either zinc finger nuclease or talons or a CRISPR-Cas9, how it works in the what are the applications of these three nucleases, either these three gene editing nucleases. So if you have a cellular genome, if you deliver these either one of these nucleases, it basically goes and binds to the target locus and basically makes the double stranded break. So this double stranded break can be repaired by either non-homologous enjoining mediated mechanism or homology directed repair mechanism. So it can be used for if you want to make a deletion, if you want to make a knockout in a particular gene, you can just deliver these nucleases to targeting a specific gene. By non-homologous enjoining mediated method, the gene can be disrupted. So, and then if you want to correct a particular mutation, you can use a donor DNA, which can be either single-strand oligonucleotide SSODN, or it can be a plasmid which contains 750 base pair, 750 to 1 KB homology arms. So, and then your particular gene of the wild type gene to correct the particular mutation. So you can co-transfect these gene editing nuclease and the donor DNA or single strand oligonucleotide. Basically it makes a double stranded break, and then by homology directed repair it can be corrected. The third one is you can also overexpress a gene at putting at a safe harbor locus in the human genome. So in the human genome there are two well-known safe harbor locus. One is the AAVS1, other one is the CCR5, so chemokine receptor. So these two locus, even if you disrupt the gene in both the genes, these genes, there won't be any cell growth, it will not retard any cell growth and development. So it can, that's why it's called a safe harbor locus. Say example, if you want to use for make it for the cell replacement, in vitro protein replacement therapy, so you can overexpress a protein of interest at this safe harbor locus and then purify the protein and then give it to the patients. So it can be used for three different things. One is if you want to make a knockout, that can be like non-homologous enjoining mediated pathway, and then you can also correct using a particular gene by homology directed repair. At the same time, you can also overexpress a protein, putting it at the safe harbor locus. Okay, so before this CRISPR-Cas9 approach came into the for gene editing, genome editing, this zinc finger nuclease was extensively used in different species, different organisms. There were several publications that already shown that this gene editing nucleases can be used for either making knockouts or you can use gene correction purposes. So our question is, why gene therapy of beta hemoglobin disorder is highly desirable? Okay, so this is the most common genetic disease on earth. It has been estimated that 44,000 of children were born with sickle cell disease in India in 2010. So this is the first molecularly defined human disease, which is the sickle cell disease in 1949. The most well characterized gene, exactly the same mutations in all the sickle cell disease patients. This is the same glutamic acid 2 valine, and hydroxyurea is the only FDA approved drug available for the treatment of sickle cell disease. Currently, as I said, no cure for both sickle cell anemia and beta thalassemia, although some patients have been treated with bone marrow transplantation. Okay, so before going into the details, I will just give a brief introduction about the developmental pattern of the globulin gene expression. So if you see in the left, the globulin gene cluster in the chromosome 11, there are five genes. So first from the embryonic, and then the fetal, and delta and beta. So there are five different genes. So the fetal hemoglobin this embryonic globulins are produced in the first few weeks in the utero development. So after that, the first switch occurs at the 6 weeks, where the embryonic globulin is silenced, and the fetal hemoglobin is synthesis starts synthesis, and it predominates for the remainder of gestation. So at birth, the second switch happens from fetal to adult hemoglobin, and it is consistent remaining period of the life. So however, some patients, they have elevated levels of the fetal hemoglobin. So the switch didn't happen to those people from fetal to adult. So this is called as the HPFH. So what is HPFH? HPFH is a hereditary persistence fetal hemoglobin. So the expression levels of fetal hemoglobin is reduced postnatally to less than 1% total hemoglobin. But individuals who inherited genetic mutations either in the promoter region of the fetal hemoglobin or they have long deletions in the beta globin cluster at the chromosome 11. So that prevent the fetal to adult hemoglobin switch. Those people expresses the significantly higher enhanced levels of fetal hemoglobin throughout their life, which is called as the hereditary persistence fetal hemoglobin. So higher HPF levels are associated with reduced disease severity. So there is the clinical symptoms of these SCD and beta thalassemia are alleviated in the patients who inherited the HPFH genotype. So hence, introducing these beneficial mutations in these sickle cell disease or beta thalassemia patients' cells, either in hematopoietic stem cells or human-induced pluripotent stem cells, using through the genome editing approach, can permanently cure the disease. So this can be, after gene correction, it can be put it back into the same patients. So that is what our idea. So there are two types. As I tell, it has non-deletion type. Another one is the deletion type, HPFH. So if you see here in this slide, so there are some point mutations which are all base pair substitutions. in the pancellular gamma globin HBG2 region, promoter region of the HBG2, and then there are some pancellular mutations also in the HBG1. So these are all the base pair substitutions in the promoter region of the HPFH. The other second type is called deletion, which are all long deletions in the beta globin cluster in the chromosome 11, which can be starts from 13 kb deletion to there are up to 105 kb deletions. So if you see here in this, so HPFH1, which has 106 kb deletion, the percentage of the HPF levels is 18 to 31%. So those who has this deletions HPFH1, it's called as HPFH1, these people's level of HPF is 18 to 30%, which 30%. So if you increase the HPF levels at least 10%, that those patients, SCD and beta thalassemia patients, can able to cope up the disease very well. So see, so here these are all the some of the deletion type HPFH. So here then we ask a question: can we able to recapitulate HPFH mutations in human erythroid cells using the targeted genome engineering approach? This is the broad question we ask. So in this slide, we are showing the proposed model of targeted genome engineering approach for the treatment of beta hemoglobin disorders. So here there are three options are there. Either you can correct the particular mutation, or you can create a knockout there are some negative regulators of the fetal hemoglobin expression. Say example, BCL11A, which is zinc finger transcription factor, which negatively regulates the fetal hemoglobin expression. The third approach is you can also create beneficial mutations in those promoter region, or you can delete the long 48 kb or HPFH1 to HPFH6. You can create either one of these beneficial deletions. So in this we are trying two different approaches. One is either you can take patient somatic cells, either blood cells or skin fibroblast, and then you can reprogram them into human induced pluripotent stem cells, and then do either gene correction, or you can disrupt the erythroid enhancers, or you can do generate beneficial HPFH mutations in the promoter region of the fetal hemoglobin. And then these HIPSCs can be differentiated into hematopoietic stem cells, specifically erythroid cells, and then it can be put it back into the patients. The second approach is directly you can take hematopoietic stem cells from the patients, do either one of either beta globin correction, or you can disrupt the erythroid enhancer, or in the you can generate beneficial HPFH mutations. So and then can be directly put it back into the same patient. So this can be used as a permanent cure. So here particularly we are interested in generation of beneficial mutations. So why we are interested in this creating beneficial mutations is, as I told previously, in the case of sickle cell anemia, it's only one mutation in the beta globin. But in the case of beta thalassemia, the patients have array of mutations. So they have either deletion, insertion, or base pair substitution. There are 200 different mutations spread across the gene, beta globin gene. So it is very cumbersome to correct the each and every mutations. So in this case, so if you enhance the fetal hemoglobin levels in these beta thalassemia patients, either using creating these beneficial mutations using gene editing nucleases, it will be a one-stop solution for both sickle cell anemia and beta thalassemia patients. Okay, so that's why we are interested in generating these beneficial mutations. Okay, so in order to do this, we are adopting CRISPR-Cas9 approach to generate the beneficial HPFH mutations. So in order to do that, you need to synthesize the synthetic guide RNA, as I told previously in the CRISPR-Cas9 slide. So the synthetic guide RNA has the 20 base pair unique sequence, which goes and binds in the promoter region. It makes the double stranded break. Okay. So and then using the single stranded oligonucleotide, we are trying to create a particular nucleotide change in the promoter region. So first we want to validate the synthetic guide RNA, so whether it is working in normal cell line. So before going into the patient cells, we want to test it in the routine cells, like cell lines like HEK293 cells. So we want to test it, so whether it is working, whether it makes the double stranded break. So in order to validate these SG RNAs, so we have designed a simple system. It's a broken GFP based system to validate this guide RNAs. So here what we have done is we have created a construct which contains the GFP, which is mutated by the restriction enzymes, and it contains the same homologous sequences. So in that restriction enzymes, we amplified the 500 base pair region, genomic region, where we have designed the synthetic guide RNA. In this case, we from the promoter region of the HPFH. So we just amplified, and then we have cloned this 500 base pair region, and then we have co-transfected the synthetic guide RNA containing construct, the plasmid DNA, and then this broken GFP construct. Basically, what happens is, so the synthetic guide RNA goes and binds to this region, the 500 base pair region, where it contains this 20 base pair homologous sequence, and it binds, and the Cas9 gene, which is present in the plasmid DNA, which makes the double stranded break. So once it makes the double stranded break, by homologous recombination, this GFP gets restored. So if you get the GFP positive cells in this. So if you see the GFP positive cells in HEK293, so it shows that this sgRNA made double stranded break. By homologous recombination, this GFP gets restored. So this shows that this sgRNA is working in HEK293 cells. So this we have validated using the T7 endonuclease assay. So you can isolate the genomic DNA. So it not only it cuts in the broken GFP construct, it also cuts at the endogenous HPFH promoter region. So we can check also using the T7 promoter assay. So that's what we have done. So here we have validated sgRNA's design to target gamma globin promoter region, which induces the double stranded break. Okay, so this is one approach. We are currently working on it to generate beneficial HPFH mutations in either HIPSCs or in patient hematopoietic stem cells for both sickle cell anemia and beta thalassemia. So as I told, we have also worked in the second approach, which you can where you can take patient's somatic cells, either old blood, and then purify it to PBMCs, or you can take endothelial cells, urinary endothelial cells, or skin fibroblast, and then you can reprogram them into human induced pluripotent stem cells. So the major advantage with this, so before going into that, what is the human induced pluripotent stem cells? So human induced pluripotent stem cells are pluripotent stem cells which can be derived from any somatic cells, any body cells, by forced expression of certain transcription factors such as OCP4, SOX2, LIN28, c-MYC, or NANOG. So these are the transcription factors, pluripotent transcription factors. You can overexpress in somatic cells and then reprogram them into iPSC cells. So in 2006-07, Professor Yanya Shinya Yamanaka, he showed that you can take somatic cells and then reprogram. So this is a major breakthrough in regenerative medicine. So initially scientists thought that only embryonic stem cells can able to differentiate them into all type of germ layers like ectoderm, endoderm, and mesoderm, all type of body cells. But this reprogramming rewinds the internal clock of matured body cells into pluripotent stem cells. So once if you create human-induced pluripotent stem cells, you can again differentiate them into all type of body cells. So that's the major advantage. So what are the applications or advantages of HIPSC? So it can be generated, as I told, from any body cells, and it is a patient specific. No embryo is involved. Since no embryo is involved, there is no ethical issues. And then iPSCs can be considered as a cell line, and it can be passaged to multiple times. You can derive a clonal population from these cells. So these are all the advantages compared to the primary cells. So you may ask a question, why you want to do genome editing in human induced pluripotent stem cells instead of primary cells? Say example in hematopoietic stem cells, so if you want to correct a particular mutation or if you want to create a knockout, you can do it in hematopoietic stem cells. Why you want to take a step back, generate human induced pluripotent stem cells and then do the gene correction? So as I told in my previous slide, the HIPSC has several advantages, but if you use primary cells, one of the major factors which influences the genome editing in primary cells is how long these cells can be cultured. And then for example, if you are aiming to derive a clonal population of targeted cells, it is very difficult to passage few passages, and then extremely difficult to get a clonal population in these primary cells like hematopoietic stem cells. The other thing is in neuronal cells or cardiomyocytes, it is very difficult to get it in these cells in a routine clinical settings. And then hematopoietic stem cells are heterogeneous populations. It is genome editing in these cells will be extremely difficult. And then finally, it's getting a biallelic genome editing is extremely difficult in these primary cells. So that's why we have taken a human induced pluripotent stem cell group. Okay, so here a proof of concept, we have shown that you can take patients' somatic cells, in this case sickle cell anemia patients, old blood, and then we have purified the peripheral blood mononuclear cells, and then we reprogram the PBMCs into human induced pluripotent stem cells, and then using gene editing nuclease like TALENs, transcription activity like effector nucleases, we have corrected the particular mutation in β-globin gene and then differentiated them into erythroid cells, and then we have characterized those cells and then studied the expression of β-globin gene. So this is a proof of concept we have shown in sickle cell anemia. So here in this slide I have shown this, this is the schematic diagram showing the TALEN mediated genetic correction of β-globin mutation in patient derived HIPSCs. So here we have designed the TALEN which targets the exon 1 near the mutation site, and then generated the donor DNA which contains the left and right homology arm. The left homology arm contains the wild type sequence which is the GAG of the particular wild type sequence, and then which also contains the GFP and puromycin which is flanked by the LOXP site. So here we have taken the HIPSCs, the patient-derived HIPSC, sickle cell patient-derived HIPSCs, co-transfected the TALENs and the donor DNA, and then here the TALENs made double-stranded break by homologous recombination. The donor DNA got inserted at the β-globin locus, and then we obtained monoallelic β-globin corrected heterozygous SED HIPSCs. Here the only one allele got corrected, the second allele is still mutant. And then since we had the LOXP site flanking the GFP and puromycin, we treated these HIPSCs and then we removed the GFP and puromycin, and then we obtained the secondary heterozygous heterozygous HIPSCs. And then with this we differentiated further to erythroid cells, because β-globin is not expressed in HIPSCs, which is expressed only in the erythroid cells. So you have to differentiate them into erythroid cells to study the expression of the β-globin gene. So this is the characterization of, so further we have characterized these HIPSCs using genotyping and southern blot analysis to make sure that the donor got inserted at the β-globin locus and the particular mutation got corrected. So we did the genotyping sequencing analysis and then confirmed that it is a single allele correction. So after the gene correction, as I told, we have pre-treated and we removed the GFP and puromycin. And then again we did a genotyping analysis. So here in the right, you can see here, we have designed primers, which is one, the forward primer present upstream of the exon 1, and then the reverse primer present in the exon 2. So if it, the gene is corrected in one allele, which should show 373 base pair because of the LOXP, 34 base pair LOXP site. If the gene is not corrected, if it is a mutant allele, which this should show only 327 base pair. So here we have taken the pre-treated secondary single allele HIPSCs, and then used these primers and then amplified the beta-globin locus, and then we ran into the agarose gel. So here, as expected, we can you can see two bands. One is 327 base pair, another one is 373 base pair, which shows that one allele is corrected, the other allele is still mutant. So we have sequenced these two PCR products, and then the PCR the sequencing analysis shows that in the exon one allele has undergone homologous recombination, and then which changes in GTG to GAG, and then also there is one LOXP site which is present in the intron 1 region. So the second allele is still mutant. So we have further differentiated these HIPSCs into erythroid cells. This involves a three-step process, stage 1, stage 2, stage 3. The first, it's a two-step process basically. First step, we have generated the embryoid bodies, and then we have differentiated further into erythroid cells. So in this second step, which involves three stages, stage 1, which includes cytokines like SCF, erythropoietin and IL-3. In the stage 2, we removed IL-3, we included only stem cell factor and erythropoietin. And the stage 3, which is the terminal differentiation, final stage, included only the erythropoiet. So here you can try to enhance the enucleated erythroid cells. So here this is the GIMSA staining which you used to in the differentiated cells, which shows the clear nuclear and cytoplasmic morphology of RBCs. So here you can see the orthochromatic erythroblast. This is the final stage of the nucleated immature erythroblast before nuclear loss. So with these cells, we have done the expression analysis, HBB expression analysis. Here it shows that one allele, if you can see here, we have taken HBG as the positive control. And then we have taken three different Cre-treated HIPSCs. These are all the single allele HIPSCs. And then as a positive control, cord-blown mononuclear cells were used. So you can see here SCD HIPSCs. The expression of the beta globulin is less than 1%, but in the single allele SCD corrected HIPSCs, derived erythrocytes, you can see that there is a 30-40% increase in beta globulin expression. So this shows that even if you correct the single allele, you can able to increase the fetal HBB beta globulin expression. So since this is an autosomal recessive disorder, single allele correction is sufficient to cope up the disease. So here we show that efficient correction of beta globin mutation in patient specific HIPSC derived erythrocytes, and then it shows these cells shows adult beta globin expression. So further, once if you do the gene reprogramming and gene correction, you have to make sure that there is no chromosomal abnormalities in these cells. So in order to do that, we have done a karyotyping analysis to make sure there is no chromosomal deletion, insertion or duplication. So in this SCD corrected HIPSCs, it confirmed that there is no chromosomal abnormality. Further, we have checked the teratoma formation analysis in the SCD corrected HIPSCs. So we have taken these HIPSCs and injected into immunocompromised mice. And then after 3 to 4 months, we have taken the tumors and then sectioned and then confirmed that these cells can able to differentiate into all type of GM layers, ectoderm, endoderm and mesoderm. So in this here, we have as a proof of concept, you can take patients' sickle cell anemia patients' blood cells and then reprogram them into human-induced pluripotent stem cells and then use gene editing nucleases, correct the particular mutation, and then you can differentiate them into erythroid cells, and then we have shown that you can revert the sickle cell mutation into normal wild type sequence. So this is a proof of concept we have shown here. All this work was done by my graduate students in the lab. Sangam Goswami, he is a graduate student, and Nupur Bhargava, who is a trainee in my lab, and then as well as Neelam Lokani, he is a SCRB postdoctoral fellow. And then the funding came from DBT, Department of Biotechnology, Ramalingam Swami Fellowship Grant, and the Council of Scientific and Industrial Research. With that, I thank you.